Hey guys, Moose here from Crafting with Moose. Today I'm going to show you guys how to do one of my absolute favorite types of crafting projects. I know a lot of the tutorials that I do on this channel are for sculpting or painting or something like that, and so I wanted to do something for people who aren't really into sculpting or who aren't really into painting or that type of crafting. What is my hair doing today? Whatever, it is what it is. I wanted to do a tutorial that was really straightforward and really easy that would use materials that most people are gonna have on hand. So for this project, you don't need any specialty tools. You don't need any specialty products. This is all stuff that you could find at Walmart or at your local craft store, or if you're a crafty person, you probably have a lot of this stuff on hand already. So before I get into the materials, I'm going to give you guys an idea of what we're going to be making. So this is a book that I made. Well, I didn't make the book. It was a hardback journal that I purchased, but it was black. But I made this textured cover for it. It's a sort of a faux leather kind of look. I made this one gray with gold and silver accents because that was just the look that I wanted to go for. You can get a much more leather look. You can also do lots of really cool colors. I'm going to show you guys a couple of different types of color schemes that you can go for and exactly how to achieve those color schemes. I really, really love this one. This one's actually on my Etsy page right now. I kind of low-key hope that nobody buys it because I like it so much. But this one is definitely one of my favorites. Anybody who knows me really well knows that like gray is like my favorite color because that's the kind of person that I am. But the materials that you're going to need for this are super, super easy to find. Like I said, nothing really specialty. You're going to need some type of a book or something that you want to cover. You can do this with boxes. You can do it with journal covers. You can do it with either softback or hardback books. I have some of these little, they're little monster books. They have flexible covers, or like the composition notebooks. I have a mini composition notebook somewhere that I did this with. I don't know where it is at the moment. So this you can also do it on boxes, cardboard boxes. That's actually what I'm going to be using today, are these little boxes. They look like almost like books. They have these little attachments on them, and the inside, this is what the inside looks like. They're like little, almost like little shadow boxes. So this is what I'm going to be using for the ones that I'm going to show you guys how to make today, because I wanted to show you different styles, and I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of these. So I'm going to show you guys a couple of different options. In addition, you are going to need some Mod Podge. Really, I just go with the regular matte Mod Podge. You're not going to need this much. This is like a gigantic tub of Mod Podge. But I use a lot of Mod Podge, and so I just bought a giant vat of it. If I could buy it in 5-gallon tubs, I probably would. Or like a drum, like one of those big oil drums full of Mod Podge. That's what I need to get invested into. But you're gonna need some Mod Podge. You could probably use another type of glue. I've used Eileen's Tacky Glue also for it. It's a little thick for my taste, but you could make it work. I have also seen people use like white school glue. The only downside I think to using white school glue is when it dries, it doesn't have as much strength as I would like for it to have. But if you're going to use it for a journal that you're actually going to be using, I would definitely recommend going with either the Mod Podge or the Eileen's Tacky Glue, because when they dry, they're nice and strong. If it's going to be for something like a keepsake, something that's going to be sitting on a shelf that you're not really going to be playing with or touching or handling, the school glue would definitely work fine. You're going to need some brown paper baggies. I bought these on Amazon, but you can get these things literally anywhere. They don't have to be the small ones. I just bought the small ones because that was what they had. You're going to need like a paintbrush or a sponge to put your Mod Podge on with. And then you're gonna need some sort of decorative colorants. I am going to use a couple of different things. I'm gonna use some just plain acrylic paint. I am gonna be using the Apple Barrel brand paints. You can use alcohol inks. I'm gonna be using the Adirondack inks, probably in gold and silver. You can use distress inks, the Tim Holtz distress inks. You guys probably, if you've watched any of my videos, know that I am obsessed with the Tim Holtz distress inks. I just, you know, they make life so much better. Probably gonna use a lot of those in this video. But really you can use anything like that, any type of paint or any type of product that you can wipe on that will dry is gonna work perfectly. So, and that's it. That's all you need for this project. You don't need anything else. Of course, you can add all kinds of crazy embellishments if you want. At the end of this video, I'll show you guys another one that I did where I put a skeleton underneath the faux leather coating. So it looks like there's a skeleton embedded in the book. I'll show you guys that later on in this video, probably towards the end. So there's lots of different ways that you can do this, and there's lots of different things that you can use, but to achieve a really nice faux leather journal, you really only need the journal, the glue, some paper, and then whatever color paints that you want to use. That's it. You can get a really, really nice end product with just those things. So I'm going to show you guys a couple of different styles, and I hope that you enjoy. Hey guys, so the first thing that we're going to do here is we're going to figure out exactly how much paper it's gonna take to cover these books. I just did that by tearing the ends off where the paper on the bags is glued together. You don't want to use those, they're really hard to manipulate. And then I just kind of laid them out to figure out roughly how much it was gonna take to cover each of my covers. And then I just started tearing tiny little pieces, lots and 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 lots of tiny pieces. You just don't want to have any straight edges. You want a variety of sizes and shapes is basically the goal that we're going for here. So yeah, you're gonna do that 9 billion times. So this is the pile that I ended up with, and it actually ended up being way more than I needed, so I have no idea how that happened. I think I counted wrong. It was really late when I was doing this. So I'm going to show you a second way that you can do your paper if you don't want to do like the little chunks. What you can do is just tear your bag open so it's one big long piece. You're going to coat it with water. I like to do that with a paintbrush that's just dipped in some water. You could alternatively use a sponge, or you could use like a spray bottle to coat your paper in water. You don't want it to be dripping wet, which is why I use a paintbrush, because it's really easy for me to control exactly how much water is getting on there. But you basically just want it to be saturated with the water. And you'll see it start to change color. And I'm gonna do the front and the back side because it makes it easier. Yeah, and there's my crusty brush. I don't know why I showed you guys that. It's my favorite paintbrush, don't judge me. So once it is nice and saturated, you're gonna wanna be really careful with it. It's gonna wanna tear. You don't want it to tear. That is like, you don't want it to tear at all. You can do a mixture of the two, and I'll show you guys what that looks like also in this video. I did so many different techniques in this video, it was ridiculous. So now you're just gonna wrinkle it up. You're just gonna ball it up like you don't care about it, and you're just gonna throw it in the garbage because it's on your last nerve, because it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and why are you doing this at 3 o'clock in the morning? Who stays up until 3 o'clock in the morning wrinkling up paper? Apparently we do. So you're just gonna wanna wrinkle it up like you hate it, and then very gingerly unfold it, and then you're gonna do that again. You're just gonna take all of your aggression out on this wet little ball of paper that is completely defenseless and has never done anything to hurt you in its life. You're just gonna just viciously attack it like an animal, basically. And then you're gonna wanna let that dry. So this is what it looks like when it dries. It's really nice and wrinkly and pretty, and it looks so nice for having been so abused. But yeah, so now what we're going to do is we are going to start the painstakingly time-consuming task of gluing down all of these little strips of freaking paper that we spent like 45 minutes preparing. I know it doesn't look like in the video it took that long for me to tear up the paper, but I did 5 of these in one sitting. I guess I did it in one sitting because I just wanted to record all of it at once so that I could get the video up ASAP. But don't do 5 of them in one sitting. Just don't do that. It took so long. It took me like 5 hours to do this. It wouldn't take nearly as long if you were only doing one. But you're going to put down a really thin coat of your Mod Podge. You don't want it to be super thick. You don't want it to be like super, super, super thin, but you also don't want to like glob it on there. Because if you glob it on too much, your paper's going to want to move around and it's going to take forever to dry. If you put it on too thin, it's not going to be strong enough and your paper is not really going to want to stick, and also it's going to start to dry really quickly. You want to overlap your paper as much as possible and create lots of lines where they're connecting. And of course, because we don't have any straight edges on our paper, these lines aren't going to be straight and it's going to look hella cool. And you basically want to just do this over and over and over again and apply a very super, super thin coat. As you can see, after I place each piece, I'm just kind of pressing it down with my paintbrush and putting a tiny little bit of Mod Podge on top of it. That's basically what you want to do. They shouldn't move when you do this. If they're moving when you're doing this, you've applied too much Mod Podge underneath them and you need to calm down. I'm just kidding, but legit, you need to calm down. If you have paper that overlaps around the edges, you can either just cut it off or you can fold it over and glue it. I had to cut mine on these because I only have like maybe a quarter of an inch of a ledge on the back side, which you can't really see, but I just ended up cutting mine off and then putting a nice thick layer of glue around the edge so they were protected. So you're just gonna glue all of these tiny little pieces on there. So after you've glued all your little pieces on, you're going to want to give it a nice medium thickness coat of Mod Podge after that first layer has dried. And so here I'm just going to really quickly demonstrate for you guys how I'm going to do my next layer. You can leave these big pieces whole and glue them like one on the top, one on the bottom, one on the left, one on the right. You can tear them into large chunks and overlap them like we did on the other one. You can do a mixture of the two styles with the two different bits of paper, just kind of depending on the outlook that you want. I did one of every possible combination that I could think of, which ended up being 5. And at the end of the video, I'll show you what those ended up looking like individually. So. Okay, so now we're gonna start the painting process. So on this first one, I actually ended up only getting footage of doing 2 of these because I'm the worst. The first one I painted blue. You're gonna wanna use real thin coats of paint for this. If you put your coats of paint on too thick, it's gonna muddy up the texture that we just spent 12 years of our life creating. Hey, look at that, that was super quick. I basically just applied a really thin first coat and then a really thin second coat after that first coat had dried. That's literally all I did. I just didn't record the whole process because I had to wait for it to dry in between. So now what I'm doing is I'm taking a darker shade of the blue. I'm just gonna take a little smidgen of it, and then I'm going to thin it out with some water so that it's kind of like a wash. And I'm just using my paint water because it was clean when I started, and it's just water. I don't even care. And I'm just gonna use my finger because why the hell not get paint all over my fingers? What else do I have to do with my life? And I'm just gonna rub it in there, and you want to rub it so that it's spread really thin. And you're basically trying to rub it down in that texture so that it causes it to stand out more. So that's basically what we're going for here. We're just gonna make our texture really pop. And you can really do this with any colors that you wanted. I just picked blue because, mostly just because I felt like it. I didn't have a good reason. And then I'm gonna take some silver alcohol ink, which is, I can't even describe to you guys how much I love the silver alcohol ink. I like the gold, but the silver one is just magical. It's just magical. There are not even words. It's like liquid silver, which makes sense because that's what it is. It's not actual silver, but I mean, that's what, you know, it's gorgeous, whatever. So I'm also going to apply this with my finger because it dries really quickly. So I'm just going to lightly brush it over the raised edges. And you'll see me here in a second. I get a little crazy because I just love the silver color so much. And I start just like, so much silver. I don't know what the hell that noise was that I just made. It's 3:30 in the morning right now. But yeah, so I went a little crazy with the silver, but I don't care. I love the silver. It's my favorite. So I'd paint the whole damn thing silver if I thought that, you know, if the silver weren't so expensive, I would have painted the whole thing silver. But yeah, you're just going to want to rub it over like the raised parts. You could probably do this a lot easier with a brush, but I like to do things the hard way. Apparently, that explains a lot about my life. But yeah, so that's what I'm doing here. Just smearing some silver stuff all over this thing that I just painted. That's basically what I do with like 90% of my time. Yeah. But look at how shiny it is. It is like so shiny. I don't think the camera really picks it up. I don't know, maybe it does. A little bit. The camera. Yeah. I had to yawn. The camera kind of makes it look like I just went crazy with the soap. It doesn't look that bad in real life. So now we're going to do the second one. And this is one of the ones that I did with the wrinkly paper technique. And this one is super, super, super easy. I'm going to use these distress inks that I'm obsessed with. And I'm going to start out with the antique linen color, which is a yellow color. And I hate the fact that the camera didn't even pick up that this color was on there. Like, you literally cannot even see it on this video, but you could see it in real life. It gave it this nice, like, aged yellow kind of tint. And my camera just decided to be a hater, and you literally can't even tell. You can just tell that it looks wet. That's it. That's all I got. Maybe in a couple places you can kind of like almost see the yellow when the light catches it, but it looks better in real life, I promise. But yeah. So, antique linen, very warm yellow color. And now I'm going to take, big shocker, vintage photo, and I'm going to really work it into those cracks and crevices. I want to get it not only on the raised parts, but also down under the raised parts and like the more flat surfaces. I don't want to scrub at it as vigorously as I did with the antique linen, because I want some of that antique linen to still show. And my ink pad was peeling there for some reason. Probably because you're not supposed to do this with them. But yeah, I just want to kind of get it everywhere. And I look at how beautiful that color is. I go on and on about this color every time I use it. But I just love it so much. It's my favorite color. It's so beautiful. And I just let that dry for a few minutes because I didn't want to rub it off when I applied my third layer. And this is the black soot. And what I did was just very, very lightly brushed over the surface with this so that it only got the highest peaks of those wrinkles with the black. And what it really does is it just kind of adds a lot of depth and character, I think, to the whole thing. And here you can see a comparison between the two sides. I think the side with the black just has a little bit of extra oomph. So that was why I went with the black on it. Yes, so much inking. I shouldn't record these voiceovers at like 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm gonna replay this video back for myself like 3 days from now, and I'll be like, Cassie, what were you even thinking? Like, what is this ridiculous voiceover? Whatever, you know what? The video was made at 3 o'clock in the morning, so it's only fair that the voiceover also be made at 3 o'clock in the morning. So
I actually had recorded the entire process of making all 5 of these designs, and I lost some of the footage, so I only managed to actually get 2 of the designs somehow while I was editing the footage. I don't know if I deleted it or I don't know what happened. But when it was all said and done and I was looking back at the video, I realized I lost some of it. So I apologize, but I am going to, go through kind of what I did for each of these. So this is the first one. This is the one, you guys actually got to see the process for this one. It's the first one that I did that we painted blue, and then we kind of rubbed the dark blue on it, and then we rubbed the silver over some of the raised bits. So that's what it ended up looking like. My camera probably isn't going to pick up all the detail, but it is what it is. And then there's this one. This one is one of the ones that I did where instead of tearing the paper into little pieces, I used long pieces. I haven't painted the insides because I haven't decided what I'm actually going to use these for yet. So I just have 5 random different designs now. So I have no idea what I'm going to do with these yet. This one, the only thing I used on this one were the distress inks. I used the antique linen, the vintage photo, and the black soot on this one. So that's what it ended up looking like. This one I only used acrylic paint on. You can see it has a really nice texture. I used a mixture of the two styles on this one. I used really large pieces of the wrinkled paper, and then I filled in the gaps with the torn up pieces, so it has kind of, you know, some really nice bits. I painted this one with a dark, really a medium brown acrylic paint, and then I watered down some black acrylic paint. I rubbed it on and then I wiped it off with a dry towel so that it just kind of barely settled into some of the creases. And I'm hoping that the camera is picking this up better than it looks like it is. I'll post some pictures also for you guys. This one is actually one of my favorite ones. I love how this one turned out just so much. This one I painted, I want to almost call it a mustard color. It's just a little bit darker than mustard. I used a really bright yellow mixed with a medium brown, just a little bit of brown in there to give it, to kind of dull out the yellow a little bit. And then I just rubbed on some gold alcohol ink. So it kind of looks a little bit like faded gold to me. And then I just barely went over like the very tops of the creases with some vintage photo distress ink to just kind of give them a little bit more depth and to kind of make it a little bit more aged look. And I'm hoping that the camera is picking the color up. The shiny ones are hard because the light just kind of catches them. And this is the last one that I did. Can't hold it. I also only used the distress inks for this one. I used the vintage photo and the walnut brown. And then just a tiny, tiny, tiny bit of the black soot. And as you can see, once that ink, well, I've got paint on my hands. Here, I'll use the back of my hand. Once the inks have dried, they're not going to rub off. This is good. You could give it another coat of Mod Podge over the top if you wanted once the paint and the inks have set. That would be completely fine. It won't mess up the design or anything. I may end up coating some of these with some gesso just to kind of dull them out. Like this one is pretty matte. This one's not super shiny. But like the ones that I use the ink on, as you can see, the ink is really, really shiny. I'm not a big fan of shiny, so probably I'll end up coating some of these with some gesso, just to kind of matte them out a little bit and make them a little less shiny. But you don't have to do that. It's not a necessary step. It's just going to take some of that shine away. So these are the 5 designs that I ended up with using exactly the same technique. And then you can, like I said, use acrylic paints, or you can use some alcohol inks, or you can use distress inks, or they also make distress sprays that you could use. I don't have any of those, so I use the ink pads. But really just whatever you have, depending on the kind of look you're going for, there is a ton of different products that you can use. I was not able to find that skull box, the skeleton box that I was telling you guys about, but I do have some pictures of it that I'm gonna post at the end of this video. If you guys would like to see a tutorial on how to make one of those, I would love to make a couple more of them actually, so I probably will end up doing it either way. If you guys would like to see that process, leave me a comment down below letting me know and I will definitely record it. It was a lot of fun. It's really similar to the process that we did for this, and I think it gives a really, really cool look. So, and that project was actually the first time, it was only the second time I had done this torn paper faux leather technique. I did it on a small notebook, a little miniature composition notebook first, because it cost me like 50 cents and I didn't want to, you know, potentially ruin something that I had paid a lot of money for. So I tested the whole thing out on a little composition notebook to make sure I wasn't going to screw it up. And when I figured out that I really liked it, I went ahead and did it on a Tim Holtz configuration box is actually what I use. So like I said, if you guys want to see the process of how to make that, just let me know and I will record that video for you. But hopefully you guys enjoyed this. If you end up using this technique on really anything, I would love to see what you guys make. You can follow me over on Facebook at Crafting with Moose. You can follow me on Instagram under the same name. Like up this video, subscribe, and I'll see you guys next time. So this is what the finished products ended up looking like. I'm super happy with the outcome. I really hope that you guys try this and that you enjoy it as much as I did. And these next pictures are of the skeleton box that I promised to show you guys with this same technique.